But that won't stop a poet if I mumble. Maybe they'll never know it. And words are just trucks to load up with music and drive through these hills with a voice and a flatbed. But if it's just an excuse to sing harmony with the woman I love, well, that's all right with me. So bring on the moons and the tunes and the rivers. The world needs all the new songs we can give her.
It's so cute.
Hello, testing. Well, good evening, everybody. Testing. Cool. Liz in the back. How's the audio? Louder, testing. It's staticky. It's very staticky, super staticky. You can't hear me at all because it's so staticky. Is that right? It's distorted. Bring it away from my mouth. Okay. We're trying that. How's that? Can anyone hear me in the back? No, not getting the audio. All right. We're just going to play around with this, David. Well, it gives me a chance to give a huge shout out to David Owens, who for many years has been our audio guru, and he owns a lot of this equipment and brings it almost every month. And when he, what is that better? People are cheering. They love it. Awesome. Eric in the corner is like, I can't hear anything. That's because the speaker's not pointing at you, Eric. I'm getting some feedback over there. Is that right? Am I hearing some weird feedback over there? Yeah. It's just really fuzzy and staticky. It's better than it was, but still getting a lot of crunchy over there. Okay. I don't know what else to do except roll with it. So I'm going to do that. And I know David's going to be trying to figure this out. So I apologize for the weird sound, but what an awesome crowd. Look at you people. Cool. Thank you, sir, for coming out to Roachport on a Tuesday evening. This is the Big Muddy Speaker Series, and I'm Steve Schnarr. I'm the director of Missouri River Relief, and we've been hosting the Speaker Series, I forget how long. I don't know, 12 years. We were just talking about it earlier today, and when we started it out, we started this in this little duck hunting cabin on the Big Muddy Refuge, which now our friend Andrew lives in, which I'm extremely jealous of. I don't know where Andrew is. What is the deal, Andrew? Where are you? That's better. Ooh. So did we have some knobs that turned themselves out of whack? Awesome. Thank you, David. Super sweet. So I do need to do some more thank yous. Braden is working the bar all by himself, I believe. Thank you, Braden. So please do tip Braden. He's working his tail off over there. And a big thank you in general to Les Bourgeois Bistro. They've been letting us take over their restaurant for a bunch of years. And we used to be down in the basement, but they decided to close on Tuesdays. So they let us come up here and we just like have our way with the place. But be kind, you know, clean up after yourselves. We appreciate it. And also a big thanks to Drew. So by the way, somebody has their phone on and they're listening on Zoom or something. Is that you, David? Like, I'm hearing myself in delay. Okay, cool. Yeah. For some reason on phones, it's impossible to turn the sound on Zoom completely off. It's the weirdest thing. But yes, and so I'll also thank you to Drew Lemberger, who has worked at Les Bourgeois forever. And even though he claims he doesn't work here anymore, he's like, he let me in today and he just makes stuff happen. And he'll be here eventually. So a couple things. You might have noticed this big table of merch. We've got River Relief t-shirts and stickers, MR340 stickers, shirts. And Christina has been working that booth. And I do need to point out that today is Christina's 1-year anniversary of working for Missouri River Relief. So we are super lucky. And I know a lot of you have been involved in the MR340 or are about to get involved in the MR340. And Christina is the one who receives and responds with grace to all of your emails. And thank you for taking care of all these people. Another thing that we are doing today is at the end of this presentation, because we love suspense, we're going to be pulling the winning raffle ticket for the kayak that you walked by on your way in here tonight. And the last I heard, and I know that this number's out of date, but this kayak, which was donated, I didn't write down their name and I'm blanking on their name. Laura Rausch from somewhere in Illinois, Springfield, Illinois, I think. Donated the canoe, the kayak and the trailer. And so far it's raised over $7,000, I believe, for Missouri River Relief. So yeah, that's putting your dollars to work. Thanks to all of you for, and now Patty, she tried to donate a boat to us last year and I just like my brain melted or something. I don't know what happened, but but now you can see how okay, good, all right, good, okay. Well, maybe we'll try that again. Then another raffle that we're going to be doing soon just walked in the door tonight as well. And Tim Sanders, do you mind standing up? So this is Tim Sanders, and Tim is an artist who hand carves and creates amazing paddles. And for many years, Tim has created a custom paddle for the MR340 and given it away to the last place finishers of the race. And this year he decided he wants to raffle it off. So we're going to do that. And on this, yeah, thank you, Tim. And it's on display right over here, embedded in here. Do you want to say anything about it, or do you just want me to say something? Okay, cool.
So I made this back in 2018. I was at the pretty much standing at the finish line with a notebook asking every racer for the hallucinations. So on this is a combination. People gave me all sorts of things. Some things I just couldn't physically draw. So but I ended up with 50 on this paddle all combined into this, and it's just a collage of all different crazy things people saw while sleep deprived. So it took me about 100 hours, but I'm donating it and yeah, hope good luck to the winner.
That's great. Thank you, Tim. And we don't have a plan for this yet, but we're thinking we might raffle it off like at the finish line party, but I'm not sure if that's what's going to happen or not. But I'm going to see somebody texted and it's Elka. And usually Elka has some good information for me, like there's no sound on Zoom or something like that. So hold on a second. I'm not sure what she's trying to tell me. She's giving me tips about the sound, but I'm not sure if that means that it's not working or what, but we'll see. Okay, so a few other things. I also want to give a shout out to my wife, Melanie, who's been selling raffle tickets like crazy over there. Thank you. And, you know, you can still buy a ticket. We're going to do this at the end, right? A couple other things in River Relief World I want to mention, and I know I'm leaving things out. So if people need to shout out things or other events coming up in the paddling community or the river community, like catch me at the end, wave your hand, and we'll make sure everyone gets to hear it. But April 15th, we're going to be in Kansas City at Kansas City Riverfront Park Boat Ramp for a river cleanup. That is always a good time. And if you can't make it to the cleanup, we'll be camped out for several days there. Come on by and visit. May 20th, we're heading up to Omaha and Council Bluffs for a river cleanup. We'll actually be camping at the Narrows County Park on the Council Bluffs, Iowa side. But I think the river cleanup's also going out from the Council Bluffs side a little downstream. But love that part of the river. And people are so nice up there. Can't wait to get back. In June is the reprise of Mornings at the River, which is a program for kids 0 to 5 down at Cooper's Landing. And there, that goes on for 3 weeks. It's Tuesday and Thursday of the last 3 weeks in June. So if you have little ones, grandkids, nieces, nephews, sons, daughters in that age range, it is not to be missed. And it's called Mornings at the River. And I'm not exactly sure if signups are open for that or not, or if anyone here knows, but then in July, from July 17th to 21st, is Missouri River Adventure Camp. I don't remember the age range for that. I think it's 5th to 8th grade. I could be wrong, but signups for Missouri River Adventure Camp start March 1st. And that's kind of a limited thing too. So if you know somebody in that age range, it's an absolute blast, a total adventure. The kids get to spend 2 days on the river, which is, you know, most people don't get to do that. I know some of you will. And I know someone who spends more time on the river than just about anybody I know, or at least in that cadre, is the reason why you guys came tonight, which is to hear from Carrie Elliott, who is a geologist with the U.S. Geological Survey based at the Columbia Environmental Research Center off of New Haven Road in Columbia, Missouri. And I'm trying to remember, last year, Carrie, you said, was it your 20th anniversary of working on the Missouri River? That's pretty amazing. That's so cool. And so she celebrated by doing the MR340. Which is amazing. And she's done several talks for us in the past, revealing some really interesting things about how the river works, the bottom of the Missouri River, what that's like. Some of those are available online. And when you're done with this, you can Google that and learn even more. But today, she wanted to really hone that knowledge of not only kind of the bottom of the river and the shape of the riverbed, but what the water's doing and how it reacts to that bed and how its behavior affects you when you're paddling on the Missouri River, which is pretty exciting. I don't think there's probably ever been a presentation quite like this, like anywhere. So this is a really unique thing. I don't know, through some weird coincidence or something, she also has another huge project that's wrapping up right now, which is with her friend Esther Stroh, cajoling the community into creating an amazing collection of quilting squares for the True False Film Festival. So they have over 340 squares that different community members have stitched, and they're almost done making this into a community quilt, which will be a celebration of the True False Film Festival. And that's really cool. So simultaneously, she's been building this completely unique from scratch presentation about the river. And the last thing I'm going to mention, because she's going to tell you more about it, is like she's one of the people that discovered a steamboat on the bottom of the Missouri River last year. So she's going to tell us about that. Thank you so much for coming in today, Carrie.
Hey, mic on? Everybody can hear me? Okay. I'm really excited about this talk. I am not an expert on the 340. Last year was my first race, but I know a lot about the Missouri River. And when I started training, I really started seeing the river in a different way than I have professionally. And I kind of understand more about how paddlers see the river. And I was excited to put this talk together to kind of put the paddling on the river with the science of the river. So everybody knows about the Missouri River 340. It is the world's longest nonstop river race on a single river. It's 340 miles on the channelized Missouri River in Missouri. There are 85 to 86 hours, depending if you're solo or in a team, to complete with checkpoints along the way. So here's a picture of the start at Caw Point and a little map along the way. I'm going to give you, just because people ask, a quick synopsis of my river experience, and then I'm going to move on to the science. But I did the race in a borrowed Wilderness Systems Tempest 165 that Sherry back there loaned to me. I read and watched everything I could find about the race. I watched all the YouTube videos. I questioned everybody I knew, and I took a lot of notes. So I felt like I really wanted to prepare as a scientist. I like to research things. I trained pretty hard in the strength and cardio. I like to ride bikes and run, so I did a lot of that. And I paddled on the Missouri quite a bit because I like to, but also I had never done sort of long distance paddling before. And when I couldn't get on the Missouri, I went on Perchie Creek or in Little Dixie Lake. I tried to go once or twice a week during sort of the warm season. I finished in 77 hours, and that was with a lot of dawdling. My whole goal was to finish. I even delayed my finish because my son and parents were stuck in traffic on I-70. So I was sort of like treading water, waiting above St. Charles, like, are you parked yet? But I wanted that photo finish with my son's, he was 12 at the time, and I wanted him to see me come in. I did kind of medium support. It's a big ask for someone to follow you along all week. And I wanted my family to take vacation with me. And so, I had friends. I kind of got my village together, and I had various friends meet me and family once per day, and they're all in the room here. And can you all, Emily, Kim, Esther, all raise your hands and thank you so much. And Josh over here. But they were fantastic. It was just great to see familiar faces. And mostly they gave me water, food, you know, positive vibes and sleep stuff. So I did sleep every night, Dalton Bottoms, Cooper's Landing. I actually slept in a bed at Cooper's for a little while, and New Haven. I relied a lot on tech. I like tech. I use tech on the river for work. So I used a Garmin GPS for navigation and an InReach for tracking, a watch so I could keep track of my speed. And I really only used my phone for backup and for communication to conserve the battery. The best part was night paddling, which was the part I was most stressed about. But it turned out to be being alone on the river at night was one of the most amazing things I've ever done. So that was my favorite part. And then also, because I'm from Columbia and I've lived here a long time, when I got to Cooper's, a lot of my friends and family were there. So that was really sort of a fun homecoming. The worst part, the last few miles that first day before Dalton Bottoms, that was my low. And then when I got to Dalton Bottoms, it was really muddy. And I was like, waist deep in mud. And that was not fun at 3 a.m. But the bottom line is I had a great time, and I couldn't wait to sign up to do it again. So I'm going to do it again this summer. So now on to the Missouri River. It's a large and heavily altered river. It's the longest river in the United States, over 2,000 miles long. It has congressionally authorized purposes for navigation, water supply, water quality, recreation, yay, right? irrigation, flood control, hydroelectricity, and fish and wildlife. There are five large reservoirs, all located in what we call the upper basin that is upstream of Sioux City, South Dakota. There's a lot of storage in the system, and that storage is sort of regulated for navigation in the lower basin. So there are 735 miles of channelized river for navigation, and I'll define channelized in a little while, but that's an important note. It's heavily altered in channel form because of the channelization. There are a few relict unchannelized reaches, and if you can get to them, I highly recommend them. There's one up near Yankton, South Dakota. So flow variability is pretty regulated below the dams, but as you move downstream, and especially in Missouri, you get a much wilder river in terms of flow. So we do get floods down here. We're in a pretty dry period right now, but the Missouri River in Missouri is very much so, you know, we get water in the floodplain in some years. The sediment load is much less than it was. It is still the big muddy, and there's still a lot of sediment in the river, but it's less than it was before the dams. So what is the channelized Missouri River? So this is a picture of the unchannelized Missouri River near Yankton, South Dakota, down here on the bottom. And on the other side is the channelized near Kansas City. So the Missouri River, before it was channelized, was much wider, much shallower, and more dynamic. It had big sandbars and islands, and it was authorized to begin sort of channel improvements, they called them, in the 1800s. They took snags out for steamboat travel. And then increasingly in the 1900s, the bank stabilization and navigation project was authorized. And that channelization continued until about 1980, when it was considered complete, although modifications continue to this day. If you were out on the river last summer, you probably saw a lot of barges with rock where they were augmenting wing dikes and revetments. So the pile and rock structures train the river and stabilize the banks. And it's resulted in a narrower and deeper channel. So here's a picture of sort of that training in action, where they narrowed the river and they put pile structures in and sort of moved it from this unchannelized state to the channelized state. And I know this is probably hard to see back there, but the way that the Corps accomplished this were these rock revetments, dikes. There's several types of dikes. You'll see these L-head dikes, which are kind of perpendicular and then parallel to the river, and these spur dikes. But these series of structures, in a very uniform way, sort of train the river into this channelized system. And this channelized Missouri River, I'm going to go over a few of the major features. This is a bathymetry map of the river. This bend is near Lexington. About river mile is 311 to 310. And you have rock features. So the wing dikes that were used to stabilize the river, the L-head dikes, which are sort of the shaped like an L, bank revetments, which are on the outside bends generally. You have the navigation channel, and I'll get into more details about this, but this is really the fastest part of the channel, and it's designed as the 300-foot wide, 9-foot deep barge traffic channel. You have a series of bends and crossovers. So crossovers is where that fastest part of the navigation channel goes to the other bank. You'll get shallower sections in those crossovers and a little more flow complexity. And then you'll also hear me use the term thawwig. The thawwig is the deepest part of the river, the fastest part of the river. It is usually the navigation pathway, but sometimes it deviates a little bit. The deepest part won't necessarily be exactly where that sailing line of the nav channel is. You get scour channels along the river. Scour holes. So these happen behind wing dikes, and often they'll scour out at high flow. You'll get really turbulent flow going over the dikes and scouring these pretty deep pools. You get sandbars. So right now, if you've been to the river or looked at the river, there are big sandbars almost everywhere. So you get these sandbars on the inside of bends, and you also get these sandbars, these smaller ones that show up at really low flow that are behind some of these smaller spur dikes. So this plot right here. I'm realizing with this room and the way the light is, it's probably hard to see, but I'll just go over the highlights. This is the longitudinal organization of the Missouri River from Kansas City over here to St. Louis. And what I want you to see, so this is Kansas River, Waverly. We've got Boonville right in the middle. Osage River comes in, Herman, St. Charles. So this is the race course. This is channel width. And what I want you to see is that it's not the same everywhere. It's pretty low in Kansas City, and it increases as you go to St. Charles. This is the construction reference plane. So this is the gently sloping line that the wing dikes are designed to. So this is sort of the slope of the river as designed. This is much steeper in Kansas City, gets lower kind of in this middle section. You see a rise around the Osage and a little bit of a rise around St. Charles. This is mean dike length. So this is the length of dikes. So smaller dikes towards Kansas City, and they increase as you go to St. Charles. And this data set here is kind of neat. This is a metric we used from Landsat data, which goes back to the 1980s, where we did a remote sensing analysis. And this was for actually endangered bird habitat, where we looked at sandbars that are exposed at low flow, where those were along the river, and this persistent sandbar area metrics. So what you can see, and this is what we know too, is that there aren't as many sandbars around Kansas City. And as you go downstream, you get more sandbars and you get bigger sandbars. So that the sort of take-home message is here, the river isn't the same everywhere. It's generally bigger as you go downstream. And relevant for the race is the big question, is river speed uniform? Or does it change as you travel along the river? And I will get back to that. But first, I'm going to talk to you about how we measure the river. So you all have been to the website where you look up the river flow, right? If you're going to go out on the river, is it low? Is it high? So how do we measure how much water is in a river? You take the cross section, and the width times the depth is the cross-sectional area. You take the cross-sectional area and you multiply by the river velocity or speed, and you get the discharge. So the unit that the US Geological Survey measures discharge in is a cubic foot per second, which is about the size of volume of a basketball. So the mean flow today, the Missouri River at Boonville, just a little bit upstream of here, is 47,800 cubic feet per second at 2 o'clock. And usually it's higher. I talk to the fourth graders when we do Missouri River Days, and the benchmark I come by is like Faro Field holds 71,000 people. And usually the flow is like 100,000. So I do that. But today, there would be more people in Faro Field if it was full than there are basketballs in the river. But we're at fairly low flow, although it's come up from what it was last week. So how much water is in the Missouri River? How do we measure it? This is a picture, a fairly old picture of one of our boats. This is in the Overton Chute, so just across the river here. This is an acoustic Doppler current profiler. We call it the ADCP. And what it does is it has sonar beams that measure particles moving, measure sort of their offset. There's four beams, and they measure the speed of particles moving in the water. Since the Missouri River has a lot of turbidity in it, a lot of particles, we can do this very well in the Missouri River. So we measure the speed of the particles, and then we cross the whole river. So we really get this. This is a two-dimensional view into the speed of the river. Red is fast, blue is slow. So there's the water column in the river bottom. So we can do that pass, and sometimes we'll do it multiple times to get a really accurate movement, gives us the discharge at any given time on the Missouri River. We use really high precision GPS for positioning. So not just the GPS that's in your watch or your phone, we use high grade survey equipment that is a real pain to procure in the federal government, things that cost a lot. So we're constantly buying new survey equipment, but we use a really high precision GPS antenna. And these three shots here show you the same place. So these are multiple measurements are made in the same location over different discharges because the river goes up and down. These measurements were all made in the same place. So you can see different discharges, the river's moving different speeds. But what the US Geological Survey does, and this is not what I do, but this is how the gauges work, is they develop a stage discharge relationship. So when you pull up the website, they're not measuring the discharge of the river constantly because those measurements are instantaneous. They're measuring the stage of the river at any given time and relating that to relationship based on real measurements. And what I'm getting at here, so this is how much water is in the river today, and this is the color on the new website does not have great contrast, but this is showing you, if you go to this website, waterdata.gov, you can pull up these measurements, you can pull up all the data that I'm showing you today from the gauges. Some of the other data is my data, but the gauge data is all publicly available. And then that data also is fed into something I think most of you are probably familiar with if you are training for the race or have done the race. So this is how much water will be in the river tomorrow or this weekend. And there's this great, great prediction website that the National Weather Service came up with, where they take river discharge and precipitation models, and they come up with sort of predictions. So what you see here, the blue line here, with the pointers, the blue line that's solid is data, and the dashed line here is predictions. So this is through the rest of the week, the river's expected to fall. And there's a nice website here that you can get to from the Missouri River Relief, or the 340 website, where the National Weather Service is actually supporting the race. It's called MR340 Support, where they have all the gauges on one page. It's super helpful. It gives you just a snapshot of the river. But what I'm going to show you here is, this is the Missouri River at Boonville, just upstream. I use this all the time. This is a great reference for paddling, but also we use it for work because it's all the predictions in one place. So now you know how gauges work. Is the river speed uniform geographically, or does it change? So the way I got about answering this question, it gets asked a lot, like, what's the speed in Kansas City? What's the speed at Herman? Is, if you can see this, so this plot here is Missouri River gauge data at Boonville. This is from November to January. See these red asterisks here? These are actual field measurements. So this is where USGS technicians from, I think it's the Kansas City office, went out in a boat, and they measured the discharge. So these are actual field measurements that have the velocity data. So it's not just stage data, but you can get the velocity data. You can actually go, they call these field measurements with channel data, and you can download it. And you can start to answer the question, is river speed uniform along the river, or does it change? So this is a little hard to see probably in the back of the room, but the blue here is Kansas City. This is velocity in miles per hour. This is discharge in cubic feet per second. And the blue here is Kansas City. The white here is St. Charles. Herman is in red and Boonville's in green. And the take home here is that the river is faster in Kansas City and slower. It gets slower as you move downstream. St. Charles and Herman kind of overlap. But why is this? Well, the river's much narrower in Kansas City. So this is the plot where I had before of channel width from Kansas City to St. Charles. Sort of the moving average of channel width around the Kansas City gauge, which is just below the Kansas River, is 275 meters. At Boonville, it's 375, Herman's 400, St. Charles is 450. Well, discharge, remember, is area times velocity. Area is going to be different. If channel width is narrower, you're going to have less area and the river is going to be faster. So it's a really kind of no-brainer answer, but I was really glad to see the data kind of verify what you feel in your boat, is that the river's really moving fast when you leave the call point and you get into the Missouri River in Kansas City. So now I'm going to move on, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the hydrologic conditions for the history of the race. Discharge increases as you move downstream, some years more than others. So this is 2006, this is 2022, and I have color-coded the different gauges here. So Kansas City's in blue, Boonville's in green, and Herman's in red. And what you can see, kind of one interesting thing, is there are low years and high years, but that Herman is often a lot higher than any of the other gauges. And what I'm calling this is the Osage effect. So the Osage River has power peaking flows out of Bagnell Dam. So this is the whole summer. This is March to January of this year on the Osage River. So this is sort of a long-term snapshot of the Osage River. And you can see it was around 40,000, which is almost as much water as in the Missouri today, until right before the race last year. It was so the river can be very different. It can be low in Boonville and quite high in Herman just because of the Osage River. And the Osage is really difficult to predict because the power peaking at Bagnell Dam can change. We have a project right now where we're working on mussel habitat on the Osage, and we don't even know what it's going to be from day to day. So Ameren doesn't always, I think that there are some emails you can get on where you can get an idea of what the flow is going to be, but the power peaking can be very difficult to predict. So the Osage can be a real wild card in what the flow is going to be during the race. So back to the hydrologic conditions, what I did is I went ahead and classified the race years into high, medium, or low. So I took the top 25% of flows and called them high flow years. The lowest sort of were low flow years under 55,000 CFS. So above 100 is high, low, and this is the mean. So the blue, what I did is I averaged the flows at all gauges over all, the full 4 days of each race. And that's the black line you see here. So that's the mean discharge. And what this comes out is some races are high flow years, some races are low flow years, but most races are medium, kind of in between. And why does that matter? Well, it matters a lot because the Missouri River is a different river if it's at low flow or high flow. So at high flow, the wing dikes are submerged. There aren't sandbars. There are no low areas near the banks. Sometimes even if it's a pretty high year, you're almost in like the top of the bank. The boat ramps are often muddy, but mud kind of depends on flow sequence. So if it's high and then it gets really low, then it could be muddy too. So mud's kind of variable. And navigation buoys in there to tell you to tell barges where the channel are. If the river's really high, those can definitely be loose. They can be loose if it's low too, but they're often sort of more unpredictable when the river's high. At low flow, the wing dikes are emergent. So you can really see them, you know where they are. The recirculation behind them can be really strong. There are big sandbars. There can be more low areas, but the banks are really high. So if you want to take a break and get up the bank, sometimes it feels like it's as high as the ceiling. It can be really low, or the river can be a lot lower than the bank. The boat ramps can be really high. Like you'll be at the boat ramp and it's a long walk up. The mud again can depend on the flow sequence. So if it came down really quickly, it's going to be muddy. But if it's been low for a long time, it's probably been cleaned off. So the race you get, it's almost like you're on a different river if it's a high flow year versus a low flow year. Is higher water faster? So this is a question or sort of something people always say that high flow years are fast years. Well, they're right. So what I did here is this is the flow. This is discharge in cubic feet per second. So the mean discharge, this is time in minutes. And what I did here is this is the first finisher up here. These are the average top 10 finish times. And this is the average top 25 finish times. And the reason I averaged is sometimes with the fastest finisher, athleticism is gonna kind of take over. But when you start averaging a lot of racers, you really start to see that in higher flow years, finish times are faster. There are some outlier years that first year. Was just kind of weird. People were figuring out how to do this race. I think the second year that was the case too. I think there might not have been 25 people. It's been a while since I looked at the, it was a couple of weeks ago when I did this, but I think it's pretty cool. Oh, in 2019, there was only one boat that finished. That was the really high year. So that was an outlier year. But higher water is faster. So it's a different river and it's a faster river in a high flow year. Are parts of the river faster? So this is a velocity map of a bend around Lexington. Blue is slow. I have this bend out by half a mile an hour. So it's 4.5 is the fastest year. And you can see this thread of fastest water really is along that navigation line. This is a 77th percentile flow. So this is 70, I think this was around 70,000 CFS at, or 75,900. So it's a medium flow. It's not, especially for the summer, it's not super low. It's not super high. Low flows are going to be behind the wing dikes and along the banks. So why does it matter? Well, when you're on the river, you're going to want to follow the navigation channel. This is really pale and washed out. I apologize for that. But you can go to the Corps website. You can download these maps. And you can see the plan navigation channel. And you'll learn about the navigation markers where the green aids are on the right bank and the red aids are on the left descending bank. And this is how you can learn. And there are other YouTube videos out there that can explain navigation on the Missouri River in great detail, how to follow the navigation channel. And I want to show you, this is the, we're here. This is the bluff top. This is the I-70 bridge across the river. And just note where the navigation channel is under the bridge here, kind of close to the middle. So there's a webcam on watching the bridge construction. And it's been there a little over a year, I think. There's flow going downstream. You can see some paddlers here. I pulled up the morning of the race. So this is July 13th, about 9 a.m. You can see some paddlers. They're pretty close to the navigation channel. I pulled up later in the day. There's paddlers on the bank here. This is my point of why it's important to know where the navigation channel. There's some way over here. This person's probably in the navigation channel. Well, why does it matter? So that map I showed you earlier, I picked out some paths here. So you can see this green path kind of hugs this bank. The yellow path follows the exact sort of mapped navigation channel by the river mile markers. The black path kind of follows a little bit of what I know is the fastest. I kind of looked at what appeared to be the fastest part of the river, which deviates from the navigation channel a little bit if you map it. And then the blue, I picked a path that hung that bank. And what that I came up with when I looked at the speed along that path is miles per hour. The average on the blue was 3.11 miles per hour. And that black line that follows sort of the core of the deepest red was 3.62. It doesn't seem like a big difference, but you know, half a mile an hour doesn't, you know, oh, that's not that fast. Well, over 10 hours, it's 10 miles. So if you choose your route wisely, the river's going to help you more. So that's why when I was showing you the paddlers in different places along that channel, where you are in the river is going to give you a bigger push. So you want to, I'll go into a little more detail of what you can do to be in the right place. But those maps are good to study and the channel markers are good to watch because the channelized river is really optimized for fastest travel in that sailing navigation line. And it does make a difference where you are. This is a plot this is a bunch of data over a wide range of discharges. So that one map I just showed you was one discharge. Well, this is a really wide range. In fact, this is super high. Like the race would be canceled if it was 300,000 CFS, but we were out the summer of 2019 and collected a bunch of data. So this plot has data over a very wide range of discharges. Most of them are at that Lexington site because we had a site where we were looking at pallid sturgeon larval habitat where we went out and measured it a ton. But there are 27 measurements, 12 of them in one place. The others are spatially all along the lower river. So sort of Kansas City to probably about the Osage. And what the blue ones, the line is here, is the mean reach velocity. So that plot I showed you, that was mean velocity. The gray here is the mean velocity average for the whole reach. The gray one is the navigation channel velocity. So that's in the along that line where the river miles were connected, that sailing line of the river. And the fastest part of the nav channel, this light blue here, is what I was showing you were my judgment of what the fastest part of the river was. And the rule of thumb that I came up with is the navigation channel is about 1.2 times that. So the average velocity, I'm sorry, I'll go back and clarify this. That's like what the gauges give you. So when I did that plot of the gauges, that's your average velocity. So the navigation is 1.25 times about, the navigation channel is about 1.25 times the average. But the Thalweg, the fastest part of the nav channel, is about 1.4 times the average. So that's a little bit of a rule of thumb that I came up with based on some real data. What I'm getting at is some math, some predictive math, to look at you know, predictions of average channel velocity for a given discharge. It varies by location. And what this is useful for is if you have your spreadsheets and you're trying to tell your ground crew where to meet you, and you're, you know, this is May, and you're trying to say if the river is this flow, this is how fast it's going to be. You could plug these types of numbers in for the different sections of river. So based on the slopes of the lines from the gauge velocity field measurement data, I pulled out the trends and the equations. And then I looked at the discharge. I did 50,000 and 100,000. So sort of a low and a high, the thresholds for low and high. And the average velocity, the nav channel velocity, and then the Tholoweg velocity for Kansas City, Boonville, and Herman. And what's really cool here is if you look at, let's just take the nav channel. At 50,000 CFS, the nav channel is 4 miles an hour at Kansas City, but it's 2.8 at Herman. So I thought that was really interesting. This is something you can kind of feel when you're on the river. And like with my GPS watch, I would notice like, we are not nearly as, you know, even when you're not paddling, this is the speed you're going. But I thought that this was a cool way to show that sort of spatial variation in river speed with the geography of the river. And the reason for this is that it's a different river. It's narrower in Kansas City. The wing dikes are shorter. There's different structural features that make the river, the sort of the speed as it is in different places. So how do you know where that fastest part, not just the sailing line, but the fastest part? Well, there's some hints. If you've been out on the river a lot, you may see these boils, swirls, vortexes. They have lots of names. This is just right here at River Mile 180, taken from the Katy Trail. I use a multi-beam sonar to map the bottom of the river. And what that gives me are maps of the dunes. So these large dunes, or the boils that you see, just going to show you this plot here. So these are the dunes along the bottom of the river. These are dunes in White Sands, New Mexico, that are in the air. They look a lot like the ones on the bottom of the river. So these dunes have turbulence created by this sort of water crashing over these crests. And that comes to the surface as shear. And that vortex is the surface sort of manifestation of that turbulence in the river. So when you see the vortex, those are really big dunes that are shedding a lot of turbulence. And those really big dunes are where the fastest water is. So, and sand-like water is moving downstream. So these boils move, and they're not everywhere. They're not in every bend, but the places where these biggest boils are is where the water is the fastest. So here's a map I made in one day. These are four passes, about an hour between each other. Notice that the navigation line is here. That's where the deepest water is. But where these big dunes are, I don't have the velocity map on here, but I made one that day, is where the fastest water is. So the large dunes move faster than the smaller dunes, and they are associated with the fastest part of the channel. Here's another example. This is near Lisbon Bottoms. You can see the sailing line. I have it in black here. That's the plot off the maps, but you can see these really big dunes just off to the side, and that's where it's darker red. So the fastest water corresponds with the big dunes. And if you're in the river and you're reading it, the big dunes are a little over. And I played this when I was training and racing this summer, and I wasn't necessarily fast for the race, but I do feel like I used the river to my advantage, so I wasn't as exhausted. And when I felt like I was in that sweet spot where the big dunes were, you almost feel like you're going downhill. You kind of hit that fastest part of the river and you can feel it. And I would often try and think about, you know, you could kind of go, you were in the navigation channel, but there's often one thread that's faster. So that was a little bit of a game I played. But it's, so these are plots of the depths and velocities. This is velocity here. In different bends, and these all are around central Missouri, and the distributions of velocity are different in different bends. So not every bend has these giant dunes. Some bends are faster than others. I think this one in particular is fairly fast because it's constricted by this bedrock on one side. and this giant sandbar on the others. So it's a place where the water's kind of deep and constricted and you get a faster bend. But the geometry of the river is variable all over the river. And it has a lot to do with local conditions such as channel slope and engineering. That's all I have about the race. I'm gonna talk a little bit about the shipwreck. So we found this shipwreck last summer and we were kind of quiet about it. I actually knew about it during the race. I think I might've told someone when I was paddling, like, hey, there's a boat near here. It's upstream of here, it's between, we've been telling people, it's near Franklin Island. It's sort of protected behind a wing dike. We were surveying for larval pallid sturgeon habitats, so these tiny little fish in the river. And we went to a place that had been netted the day before, and we went to survey the habitat. And we had our fancy sonar broke. So we had a side scan sonar out. This is a hummingbird sonar that you can go buy at Bass Pro. And we went to our spot we were supposed to survey that day, and it was one of those 100-degree days. We were hot and bored, but we were watching the sonar as it comes in, as we should, and we saw this, and we immediately said, that's not sand, and that's not rock, and it's not a tree. Because you see, when you look at the bottom of the river a lot, you see a lot of sand, and maybe some rocks and trees, nothing else. So we saw this, and I've worked on the river for 20 years and with a lot of people, and we always joke, we're going to find a steamboat. Well, we saw this and my coworker Ty Helmuth and I looked at each other and we said, that's a steamboat. So we went upstream, we came back down and we got this pass and we did that pass and we said, I think that's a steamboat. So that's from two different directions with the side scan. Well, later in the summer, our fancy sonar came back from Denmark. It was getting repaired. We went out and surveyed the area. So there's a little wing dike here. This is a very generic looking spot, I promise. This is the main channel here. So the thalweg, the fastest part's way over here. Here's the dike. It's kind of protected in here. So the boat is really small. We went out there to resurvey it. And we almost didn't find it. Here's a zoom in on it with our the way this is gridded. This is the boat here, but it's kind of hard to see on this digital elevation model, but it's about 100 feet long and about 16 feet wide. It's heavily damaged. So those are probably the minimum dimensions. Here's a picture of a point cloud. So the point cloud kind of outlines it in a little better detail. Here you can see it here from a different angle. It's buried in the sand and we went out and surveyed it twice and it looked pretty different the two times. So the sand's actually depositing on it and scouring out. We're kind of excited to go survey it this spring. It's our new place we test equipment. And we have to test our equipment. So here it is again. You can kind of see this spot in the hull and this long, skinny spot. Here's a map from the Missouri River Commission of the steamboat wrecks of the Missouri River. Here's sort of the region of the maps, or the region we were in. So these maps and where steamboats were mapped, they're not very accurate. People didn't have precision GPS, and the river moves. So we went out and sort of the consensus is we don't have enough identifying features to know for sure, but we did have an archaeologist from the Corps go with us and we're pretty sure it's probably the Martha Stevens, which went down in 1874 and was a stern wheeler. These are the other sort of possibilities in the area, but it's probably the Martha Stevens. And I did some sort of quick newspaper research. And again, probably Howard to see, but I'll read some of this because it's kind of fun. Boat left Adams Landing, I'll read it from here, across about breakfast time on the morning of Saturday, August 7th, 1884, loaded to the guards and proceeded upriver, bound for Boonville. After leaving the South Shore and entering the chute at Sibley or Turkey Island, while crowding the upper reef and headed for the bight of the bend, inland shore, she ran away from the reef and down on the nest of snags. She struck about amidships and was a total wreck for a few minutes and sank floating into the inland shore, somewhere in the neighborhood of the towhead abreast of Sibley Island. Six lives reported lost. Boat was valued at $10,000. Cargo consisted of 3,000 sacks of wheat. Boat and cargo were insured. This account here, it was slightly different. I think there were 4 lives lost. There wasn't a lot of information. I thought with 6 people died, I'd expect a big story. But the reality is there were so many steamboat wrecks on the Missouri, it probably wasn't big news. And there wasn't a treasure. Sacks of wheat. All the accounts talk about the sacks of wheat and the cargo. I mean, it was valuable, but just pretty minor steamboat wreck in terms of steamboat wrecks. It was sacks of wheat. Did anybody dive? yeah, so it was kind of a fun little thing that happened last summer. But really the cool thing is there are a lot of unknown steamboat wrecks on the Missouri. So when you're paddling by, maybe your hallucinations for the next race can be about the steamboats down there. So in summary, the river engineering has created a fast navigation channel for racing. So because it's a channelized river, it's actually a great river for a continuous river race. It's not the same along the course. So the river engineering changes and the river changes. The speed of the river at a given discharge is different along the river, which I think is really interesting. I mean, I'm kind of glad it's fast at the beginning because you have a lot of adrenaline and you're going, but it slows down a lot around the Osage. and maybe it's the time of day too. It's hot and longer. The race conditions vary by year. So high flow years, which I'm calling above 100,000 CFS, are very different than those low flow years. And medium flows are in between and the most common. High water and low water create very different river conditions, almost different rivers. Higher water is faster water. So maybe we can hope for high water this summer. We had kind of medium last summer. And where you choose to navigate in the river matters. Stay in the navigation channel. Even better, follow the sailing line, that river mile line. There's even some digital versions of it that are floating around that you can probably find on the River Miles Forum or on the Facebook group. There's a lot of great resources and people have linked to files. But reading the water and knowing sort of experimenting with where the fastest thread might be, it's often, I would say, just off the navigation channel towards the center of the channel a little more, but it depends by bent. But I would say that if you're really kind of, I make a game of it a little bit because it's kind of boring to be on the river for days on end, but if you're sort of hunting for the fastest water, then it gives me a mental exercise and it actually helps you race faster too. But conditions are going to vary by bend. So it's a variable place. And with that, I'll take questions. Also, if you stop at Cooper's Landing ever, my research group developed this map, which is a fun what's on the bottom of the river map. And we have this is for our paddle sturgeon research. We have a blog that's full of the steamboat. We first posted it there. There's little interesting river tidbits and research tidbits about what we're up to. So it's kind of a fun place to look for information.
That is totally amazing. And so we're up for questions and Lisa and Kevin are going to have microphones and they're going to chase you down. So if you could raise your hand, if you have a question and wait till a microphone gets to you, that way people online can hear and everyone in the crowd can hear too, hopefully, if the technology works. There was something else I was going to say. Oh, yeah. So what's the best music to listen to make you go faster on the river?
You know what I did? I crowdsourced my music. So I asked friends to give me what they thought would be fun and motivating. I would say that there's a version of Proud Mary.
With Tina Turner?
Tina Turner. I think that was my favorite.
Yeah.
But I mean, someone recommended the Beastie Boys, who I don't regularly listen to, but that was fun. Like I really enjoyed sort of having a big, varied list and putting it on shuffle. And I felt like the right music happened at the right time for me.
Well, hopefully we'll have a point cloud of that later that you can work up for us, but.
So there's certainly.
Hey, Carrie, I just wanted to say that some real world ground truthing below Herman, downstream of Herman, the river kind of switches back and forth the banks a lot of times, and it's hard to figure out where you are in the channel. And I thought about you when we spoke about this last year. Following the boils down there was way easier than trying to figure out where the channel was based on the navigation markers. So it does work. So you can trust her work.
And you were faster than I was.
My brain also melted at one point too. So there's that.
So hi, Carrie. Thank you so much. Really, really great presentation. Really informative. This is my first year doing the 340. I grew up on the Missouri River and was kind of always told, like, don't paddle on that river by people because, you know, it's dangerous. So I'm really excited to kind of do this. Growing up there, the boils, the swirls, the vortex, whatever you want to call them, you know, that would be my like heading towards those would look concerning. But just to clarify, you want to head towards those if you see them to kind of ride that wave after them, to wave tongue in cheek, of course.
So I wouldn't. Yes, I've gone over many boils at a range of discharges, probably under 120,000, and been fine. I will say that at very high flow, that 300,000 survey we did in 2019, I saw the biggest, scariest boils I've ever seen, and we had 290 horsepower motors, and we went through them, and I thought, those are boils. But in general, they're just swirls. I mean, some people don't like going through them because it does require a little steering, but it is the fastest water.
Thank you. Hey, Carrie, thank you. Can you hear me? Thank you so much. This is absolutely fantastic. So any advice? So I feel like best laid plans, you sent me lots of great spreadsheets. Plans for my own race are one thing, but what is advice you would give to ground crews who are trying to sort of game their racers' imagination about what that race might look like and do a little sort of productive second guessing of their racer?
So I'm going to give a big shout out to the app, the river tracking app. Someone remind me of the name of it because I can race owl. I have a brain melt right now. Racel is fantastic and it gives you predictions. So Josh was able, you were kind of guessing my predictions, I used some science, so I was pretty right on, but Racel actually gives you forecasts. So your ground crew is going, as long as they have access to the internet, is going to be able to sort of, and you're going to be in touch, but Racel is fantastic. And it does a lot of the math for you. It's the sort of the numbers I came up for, sort of, you don't know what the flow is going to be. So in May, maybe you're coming up with some scenarios about where you might want to sleep or where you might want to eat. And that's where plugging in numbers are nice.
If I understood it correctly, it seems like you said the inside of the channel line is generally the fastest, is that correct? Like maybe 50 feet?
It's a little inside, yes. If you have it, what I found, what helped me realize this was the data, but also a GPS watch. And I sort of was going across the channel and I would feel that fast. I would go, oh, wow, I'm going half a mile faster right here. And then I'd go home and look at data. The bigger dunes are often just off of the sailing line. Towards the middle of the channel, but not over by the wing dikes.
Towards middle of the river.
Middle of the river, okay. Yeah, but not over by the dikes. A lot of people, I noticed, at least, you know, on day one, you're really bunched up. And a lot of people love to be right by the bank on the outside bend. And it looks fast. There's almost this sort of illusion that water's fast. But there's a lot of eddies over there, and I've looked at enough cross-section data that there's slow water over there. So it might look fast, but it's almost like an optical illusion. You don't want to be up right along the bank.
It takes you more time to cross to that outer side.
Yep. Yep. But it's almost, I found it was so hard to cross through all the people on day, like the first couple hours.
One of the things that I do when I'm paddling upstream is to crowd the bank because the dispersion of the water hitting the bank actually slows down the water, you know. So that's one of those things when to use that slower water, not in a racing situation. I mean, racing is one of the special paddling excursions on the river, but going upstream is another one. And that knowing where the slack water is, where the eddies are, is equally important for the pleasure.
Yeah, and that's a great way to train, is to go upstream and then go down if you don't have a shuttle. Also to get almost treadmill work.
Hey, Carrie, great talk. Thank you. I'm just wondering what the effect of wind might be on you, whether in some cases you might be better off getting out of the channel or being closer to one of the banks to avoid the wind.
Agreed. The one day, so there wasn't a lot of wind in the race this year, and wind changes as you go around a bend. But I think above 15 miles an hour, wind becomes a real factor. And I went out one day this spring, and I think it was like 18 or 20 miles an hour. And there were standing waves around Cooper's Landing, and I called Josh to pick me up early. I think he picked me up at Hartsburg, and I looked at him and I said, if that happens during the race, I'm quitting. And I was really determined to finish the race, but wind can be a huge factor. And yeah, it may be advantageous to stay in calmer water in some places. Just the standing waves when the wind is high are scary because the water will crash into your boat.
Hi. I just had a question about the dunes. How tall do the dunes get, high and low flow?
So the big ones that I showed you, that last slide at Lisbon Bottoms, some of those are 2 to 3 meters high. So this, I don't know how high this ceiling is, but pretty high. At low flow, they're going to be a lot lower. It's interesting. I actually have a data set. It's in the talk I gave during the pandemic. So it's on YouTube, where we looked at the dunes over that really big flow in 2019. So at low flow, you know, they can be more like half a meter, but at high flow, they're quite high. It also depends. So dunes are really tricky. It depends on the sediment transport. So towards the end of a flood, often, there's so much sand, it's almost like sand starved. So much sand has gone through the system that you'll get weird kind of small dunes even at high flows. So there's a lot of things at play with the sediment transport and where you are in the flood that affect the size of the dunes.
So do you have any secret predictions from all your fancy tools about where the river's going to be for this race?
I'm kind of hoping for medium high water. I think just follow the boils is my best advice. But they're not everywhere. I would say some crossovers often, I would say some bends have boils, but they will kind of die out. And then you sort of, crossovers are weird in terms of flow in general. The thaw weight kind of dissipates. You don't necessarily have as concentrated flow. So the velocities will slow down. Sometimes it's the river's really variable.
Hi, thank you for being here. The question is the buoys. Mm-hmm. I know you don't have anything to do with those, but if you know anyone in the Coast Guard or whoever puts them down, could you let them know with all the technology, we don't really need them?
It is the Coast Guard. You are correct about that. Yeah, the buoys are, they're tricky.
You don't know anyone?
You know, I don't know the Coast Guard. I know a lot of people in the Corps.
I did have a public comment period about the Yes.
It does seem like digital buoys are a thing now. And then,
and I hope everyone, you know, put your input into the Coast Guard when that happens. But I will say that what came out of the navigation industry is that they're extremely useful in tight places. So basically, the navigation industry was trying to tell the Coast Guard where the very difficult bends are, so that they would try to put buoys in those places, because that's when it actually is really helpful for triangulating. And when we've had these low water years like we've had lately, it's even harder to like work those barges around these bends. So then the buoys become more helpful for them. But like you said, I mean, we all know that they have all of the power of GPS and, you know, all the things too, you know. So I think it is helpful to continue giving that feedback to the Coast Guard. And maybe there's some organized way that we could do that again. You know, we just did it 2 years ago, but just to kind of keep that mode up. And the trick is that we do want the navigation signs on the side of the river. Those are extremely helpful to people in, you know, recreational craft or paddling craft or whatever. They would like to get rid of those because they sort of flip that and they're like, oh, everyone's got GPS. They don't really need those signs anymore, you know, but that's the one we need, right? We don't need the buoy. So we, you know, yeah.
And trim the trees around those.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah.
You mentioned using your smartwatch app a few times. What app do you use? Just, you know, there's multiples out there for these kind of things.
Yeah, I have a Garmin and I just use the Garmin sort of, I modified the bicycle tracking to give me the regular kayak didn't have a miles per hour. So I kind of made a custom, but I use Strava like for stats once I download, but I had a Garmin and I actually you can charge a Garmin live while you're on the river because I wanted that continuous thread.
Cool. Thank you.
Thanks. Hey, Carrie. Thanks. Yeah, it's great that you were willing to come up here and give this talk. This is kind of out in the weeds, but I've done the 340 with Linda a few years, and one problem with being out there, you have a lot of time to think. And sometimes, you know, you get way out in the weeds. But anyway, this idea of staying on the inside edge of the channel occurred to me to be a good idea because you would shorten the race. And over a 340-mile race, if you just shortened it a percentage or two, that would be significant. So we tried to do that, but in a little boat on the river, it's hard to judge where you are in that in the foul wag. So I started looking at the banks and I'm like, man, the water is flowing way faster, like along an L dike. And there are some people who do the 340 that say the water speeds up along the L dike. But after looking at that for a while, I'm like, well, the L dike is still and the water's moving. So it looks like it's going a lot faster. So stay in the middle, don't edge over there, because even though it looks like it's going faster, it's more of an optical illusion. So a bunch of different things there, but I know you'll tell me if I'm way out in the weeds and wrong. So if you have a thought on that, I'd love to hear it.
There can be a fairly, because the L dikes are often right before a crossover and they're really trying to train that thaw wag to go over to the other side. So there can be some fast water there. In general, I just don't like to get too close to dikes. At high flow, you're fine. At those medium flows where they're somewhat emergent, they're scary. And at low flow, you know, you can see them. I'd have to look at the data really to see. I know that optical illusion, especially next to the revetted bank, is true. But I could look at some data and let you know and how to get a hold of you.
One of the dangers about crowding the L dikes is the eddy behind it that can catch you and pull you in. So you want to, that's another reason for giving them birth.
I give dikes as much birth as possible, paddling and in a motor rig. you don't want to tear your lower unit off.
If you can figure out a way of using it, once again, it's a better upriver tool than a downstream race.
But I do think learning how to navigate eddies is important, especially for pulling into boat ramps. You know, a lot of times boat ramps are behind a dike. So learning how to use an eddy is a great skill.
More and more of us are paddling in winter paddling and in the frazzle ice. And one of the dangers of that is icing up on the banks and being able to get out. And the bottom and the eddy scoured bottoms of the wing dikes are usually clearer for egress.
Interesting.
Do you have a feel for the relative speed of the paddlers compared to the speed of the water? How much of this 340 miles is basically being in the river and trying to find the right place, and how much is paddling?
Fitness is huge. So strong paddlers are faster, and boat length and type is also huge. So I'd say that there's sort of three components. There's knowing the river and using the river wisely and doing things like grabbing your sandwich and eating in your boat. Because even if you're on your bank eating your food, you're not moving. But if you're sitting in your boat and you're in the thawweg, well, you're going down at 3 miles an hour. If you're in the right spot while you're eating, while you're not paddling. But strong paddlers are adding another, I'm thinking like, might go 8 miles an hour, 9 miles an hour. So they're going maybe 5 miles an hour with their engine. And then, so all the numbers I have are what the river's giving you. And then you would add what your speed is, your flat water speed onto that.
I have a question that isn't related to racing. But it's when I've been paddling on the river, sometimes I have this illusion that when I'm going downstream, I'm going uphill. And it caused me to think that the underlying base of the river is not a constant downward flow, that there's got to be ridges that the river is pushing up over. And that in fact, sometimes when we're going downstream, we might be actually going uphill in a few places.
So with our high precision GPS and our multi-beam, if we do a profile down the river where the big dunes are, you can actually see the water surface. And we're talking 10 centimeters over a distance. It's not much, but the water surface actually gently mimics the dunes. So there is a little bit of, it's tiny, it's centimeters of an uphill slope and then a downhill. And that follows not only the dunes, but also the big bar forms. So the crossovers might have bars that are bigger than dunes. So made of lots of dunes, these sort of bars that it's what the barges will sometimes have trouble on are these bars that are also moving through the system. I think a lot of them sort of, the flood of 2019 moved a lot of sediment and some of these bars caused problems at certain bends. And then when the water came down, it was a real problem for some of the barges. And I think there are places where centimeters, but the water surface is actually, and in that one plot I showed really quickly of the dunes, the water surface is wavy in the same shape as the dunes.
It made me think of the topography of mountains where people go through passes. It's the low place in the mountains and the river finding its lowest point across some high, hard places.
Also in a bend, there's elevation change. So it'll be super elevated on the outside and down towards the sandbar on the inside bend. And so there's slope in both directions. It's tiny, but rivers aren't flat or nor are they gently completely sloping straight lines.
Someone was telling me there's online questions as well. So I don't know, maybe take these back to Mel. Maybe somebody wants to buy their last ticket or something. Okay, sorry about our friends online. Where are these? Really? So who, what? There's questions on, oh, maybe on YouTube. Okay, we'll try that.
Who's doing the race this summer? I'll talk to anyone about the river during the race. So if you paddle near me at all, I'll talk about the river for 4 days. I was paddling next to someone, I think, who didn't believe me. I was talking about the boils and I was getting a little bit of like, what do you know? And I was like, I am the world expert on this river, which I never say, but 20 years of literally serving for thousands of hours. The boils are because of the dunes.
Yeah, there. Did you vote?
I did.
What'd you get?
I got a 18-foot stellar sit-inside kayak. I don't have it yet. It's ordered, but I'm excited to have something very light. What I'm really excited about is for going out and paddling, I can lift it and I can put it on the car alone. And it's a lot to have a heavier boat. It's hard on the body. So I treated myself to a new boat. But there's a, someone's going to get a new boat tonight.
And we were hoping you could pick the winning ticket, right?
Pressure.
Have you guys been shaking these all night? Yeah, okay, good. All right. So they've got the whole list of numbers back there, so.
Well, I have to call out the number.
You do.
All right.
I know, right?
344-274. I don't think you have to be present to win, right?
No, you don't have to be present to win. No.
The draw.
Everyone here is like, the crowd's getting restless. I don't know.
Oh.
Cinda Eichler? Yeah. Cinda Eichler? Yay! She's done the race a couple times. She's done the race a couple times.
Yeah, and Cinda lives in Colombia. So, Cinda, what? Where are you, really? No. Yeah. Well, I'm calling her. That's awesome. Thank you. Do you have anything else to add?
That's
Thank
it.
You so much, Carrie. That was so awesome.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you guys so much for coming. Thank you, Carrie. And thank you also to USGS for understanding the importance that our community understands the river as well as we can. And for letting you to come share the knowledge that you gained on the job. We really appreciate that. Thanks to all of you guys. Super thanks to Les Bourgeois. And the next month, next Big Money Speaker Series is, I forget the date. It's the second Tuesday in March. And it's Steve Snell, who paddled the entire Missouri River last year. And he did multiple paintings every single day. So he's going to share some of the paintings that he did coming down the river, and just like the experience of his trip. And Steve is a hoot. He's an art professor from the Kansas City Art Institute, and he'll be with us next month. So I hope to see everybody next month. If not, we'll see you on the river.
There's something happening here, but what it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. There's battle lines being drawn. Nobody's right if everybody's wrong. Young people speaking their minds are getting so much resistance from behind. Every time we stop, hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. What a field day for the heat. 1,000 people in the street singing songs and a carrying signs. Mostly say hooray for our side. It's time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Paranoia strikes deep into your life, it will creep. It starts when you're always afraid Step out of line, the man come and take you away. We better stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going. We better stop. Hey, what's that sound? What's going? We better stop now. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going. We better stop. Children, what's that sound?
Flows and flows of angel hair, and ice cream castles in the air, canyons everywhere. I've looked at clouds that way, but now they only block the sun. They rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done. But clouds got in my way. I've looked at clouds from both sides now, from up and down, and still somehow, if clouds illusions I recall, I really don't know clouds at all. Don't let them know. Don't give yourself away. Sad part, I really don't know. And feeling proud to say I love you. I've looked at life that way, but now friends are acting strange. They shake their heads. They say I'm trying, but something changed in living every day. I really don't know now at all.
Midnight on the water, Sunday on the lake, a beaver or an otter steals across the moonlit wave. Foolish moth undaunted by the screen upon the door, bumps his head instead of leaving, comes on back for more. Choruses of crickets sound, the car across the way, the dark of night and the covers down, fond memories of the day. Potted plants, the dance of sweet fern, shuffled by the green. The shadow of a bat swing in the shelter of a tree. Northern lights that flicker, wicker chairs upon the lawn. Coolness of late summer and the still before the dawn, with smoke from the campfire drifting slowly to the sky, the shimmer of a school of white birch, the spark of firefly. Good night on the water, sand and cedar air, a quiet place, your suntan face, and the summer in your hair. Boats and floats and wild boats growing sweet beside the spring. Good night on the water.
Oh, give to me a winding stream, it must not be too wide, where waving leaves from maple trees meet from either side. The water must be deep enough to float our small canoe, with no one else but you. Oh, do not disturb my waking dream and the splendor of my winding stream, flower in my canoe. Her eyes, they looked me through. My maiden fair with golden hair is very much like you. The sparkling trout beneath the bank doth leave his hiding place. Kingfisher there from bough above, so eager to give chase. The spreading branches overhead, the sunrise peeping through. When looking down at you, oh, do not disturb my waking dream and the splendor of that winding stream. Oh, flower in my canoe,
Her eyes, they looked me through. A maiden fair with golden hair is very much like you. A maiden fair with golden hair is very much like you.
Everywhere to the old buffalo, I know he don't roam here no more. And at school today, they say he's gone away, and no one ever says just what for. Oh, listen, my son, tell you how the West was won, how them herds fell to the big needle guns. But the ghost of them herds still found no earth, and the spirit is still on the run. And the spirit is still on the run. It's American dream of an arm. When the memory is free, but the wine to me, and the spirit is still on the run. Anyone ever happened to the old grizzly bear? I know he once roamed the west wide. And at school today, to push back to sting in the mountains where he has to hide. Oh, listen, my son, tell you about these proud ones, where they stalk all others, walk small. But man, to his shame, can't stand the untamed, and there's some that wouldn't have them at all. The spirit is still on the run. It's a American dream going on. When the memory is free, but do you mind to me? And the spirit is still on the run. Anyone ever happened to the big piney forest, the prairies that stretched out like seas? Because the school books, they say, these were all in the way when the settlers come a-swarming like bees. Oh, listen, my son, hey, all these have gone. It's sad, but it's not been in vain. When the lake's blood was bought, and when the spirit it brought, a whole country was born into fame. And all that have died or been swept to the side, they still give us hope, everyone. They give us dreams of the free and what has been and can be. And the spirit is still on the run. And the spirit is still on the run. It's a thing. When the memory is free, but they mind to me, and the spirit is still on the run. And the spirit is still on the run. It's an American dream, but now, when the memory is free, but they mind to me, and the spirit is still on the run. And the spirit is still on the run. Thank you.